Now I will be teaching on the gift of tongues. Through men of strange tongues, I will speak to this people. 1 Corinthians 14:21. Why is there such a thing as the gift of tongues with interpretation? When prophecy gives directly the message of the Holy Spirit in one's own language. First, what God does is always well done, and it is not wise to second guess God. Second, Isaiah prophesied by the Spirit. With foreign lips and strange tongues, God will speak to this people. Isaiah 28:11. Third, Jesus himself said, these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name they will drive out demons. They will speak in new tongues. Mark 16:17. Thus, tongues are God's idea and operation. Anyone who criticizes tongues is criticizing God. Before the day of Pentecost, when salvation was of one nation, the Jews, the mother tongue was sufficient as a vehicle for the Spirit's message. But on the day of Pentecost, salvation became available to all people and nations. So other and many tongues are now chosen by the Spirit as the vehicle through which to speak. The different languages the Holy Spirit speaks at the time of his incoming is indicative of the fact that now he wants his message to go to all nations, to the ends of the earth, Matthew 28:19 and Acts 1:8. The manifestation of tongues at Pentecost was an indication that God intended to undo the confusion and separation that came at the Tower of Babel. He is now ready to bring his people together. John 11:52 states, and not for that nation, but also for the scattered children of God, to bring them together and make them one. The word tongues identifies a gift which enables believers to speak in any language foreign to them and not previously learned. Those who speak in tongues have deliberately submitted themselves to the Spirit's control. Tongues occur as a natural function of the human organs of speech. The difference being that the choice of words is controlled by the Holy Spirit instead of by the rational processes of the human being. Paul pointed out that the ministry of tongues is to generate belief or to confirm the presence and voice of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 14:22. When an observer hears a language spoken by someone he knows is otherwise incapable of doing so, he is being brought face to face with a miracle. Paul emphasizes that all things be done for edification. 1 Corinthians 14:26. The biblical word edification is used literally to denote the process of strengthening or establishing moral beings. When the gift of tongues is manifested, the Holy Spirit always desires the edification of God's people. When a communication in tongues is made intelligible by being interpreted, It stands to edify the church. The gift of the interpretation of tongues provides the Spirit-imparted ability to know directly and intuitively that what God is seeking to communicate in tongues. Tongues plus interpretation serves to unveil the mind of God to His people. When people speak with tongues, the language is that of the Spirit, while the submission of the vocal organs for articulation is the part of the human speaker. The divine objectives accomplished through speaking with tongues concern the believer and his relationship to the body of Christ. Those speaking in tongues are also concerned with attracting the attention of the unbeliever, as well as being used for a sign to unbelievers and for edification in times of prayer. Tongues are a vehicle for messages from the Holy Spirit to the church. The gifts of tongues and interpretation are greatly beneficial to congregational worship. They supplement other ministries of the church. They comfort, edify, exhort, refresh, restrain, and inspire all believers. Paul encouraged the church at Corinth to seek the gift earnestly. The man who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret what he says. 1 Corinthians 14:13. The spiritual enablement which accomplishes the divine purpose is described as a sudden falling upon the human agent by the Holy Spirit. It is similar to the swift descent of the power of the Spirit at the time of one's initial filling with the baptism with the Holy Spirit. Evidence of this kind of sudden falling upon by the Holy Spirit would include Zacharias, who was first made mute and then given speech as the prophecy concerning John the Baptist was fulfilled. Luke 1:64 and 67. Simeon, who allowed the Spirit to use the voice, Luke 2:27-35. Anna, who prophesied the moment she saw the Christ, Luke 2:36-38. And Stephen, speaking with the Holy Spirit's power, Acts 6:10. It was not Stephen speaking, but the Holy Spirit speaking on his behalf and through him. These examples show the clear distinction between an utterance intended to reveal divine truth to others and the speaking in tongues that Spirit-filled believers enjoy in private times of devotion. Now I will be teaching on the interpretation of tongues. The man who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret what he says. 1 Corinthians 14:13. The interpretation of tongues is also a divine enablement vastly superior to human thought and volition. It is an inspired explanation in commonly understood language of an inspired utterance in unfamiliar tongues. The interpretation is no less supernatural in its origin than is the message in tongues to which it applies. The Spirit-filled Christian, when he is exercising either gift, has no mental concept of the syllabic patterns of his utterance until they have been articulated. Certainly this was the way it happened when the disciples spoke with tongues on the day of Pentecost. Their minds knew nothing of their foreign languages they uttered, since tongues and interpretation are both vocal gifts. The operative work of the Spirit is similar in each. He places the divine utterance in the vocal organs and not in the mind. Interpretation of tongues has nothing to do with the interpretation of Scripture. That is the work of the teacher. Interpretation of tongues is a supernatural gift, like the gift of tongues or the gift of miracles. It is entirely dependent upon the gift of tongues and has no function apart from that gift. It is an interpretation or giving the sense of that which has been spoken in the gift of tongues. The interpreter of tongues, who speaks as the Spirit gives utterance, need not give a word for word exact translation of the message in tongues. The word translated, interpret, means to explain thoroughly, to give the sense and the significance of. It carries the idea of explaining thoroughly and carefully the full meaning of the words, such as Jesus did on the road to Emmaus when he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. Luke 24:27. Consequently, the message in tongues may be short but have a much longer interpretation. For example, when Daniel interpreted the handwriting on the wall to Belshazzar, he used three sentences to give the interpretation of three words. He needed to explain the meaning of those words. The words recorded in Daniel 5:25 are "Meni, meni, tekel, euphorson." Their exact translation is "numeration, numeration, weighing, division." Daniel could easily have said that much and stopped. However, because the Holy Spirit also wanted people to know what those terms meant, Daniel's duty was not simple translation. He was to read the writing and give its interpretation. He knew the interpretation came from God, and he spoke by the inspiration of the Spirit when he foretold the judgment coming upon the Babylonians. The words of the written message were first translated, and then the translation was interpreted. The quality of the message in tongues will be judged by the interpretation, for the interpretation is all that is understandable to the hearers. The message must be for edification, exhortation, or comfort for the church body as a whole. The Spirit-filled believers listening will be able to sense whether or not the message has served this main purpose for all messages. The gifts of tongues and interpretation are meant to be aspects of the effective functioning of the overall body of Christ. The relationship is cooperative and not competitive for the advantage of the entire church body. The gifts of utterance are to function always under the umbrella of love. 1 Corinthians 13:1-2. Divine love is absolutely unselfish. To function in this love, spiritual gifts must never offend or impose upon those to whom they minister. God is responsible for bestowing them, but we become responsible to receive and manifest them. Lord, we love you and we thank you for your word, and we thank you for giving it to us too. Lord, bless all these dear friends and loved ones. In Jesus' name, amen.